I thank you for the opportunity to give you a short overview over present and future developments of environmental regulations and standards as far as shipping industry and ports are concerned. I will address a few examples of the development of regulation, the implementation and enforcement, and the monitoring of compliance. I am one of these sluggish authorities we heard in the morning with the Federal Agency for Shipping and Hydrography. We are part of the German Flag State Administration, and inter alia, we do the monitoring and research projects which deal with questions of the impact of the environmental impact of ships and offshore industry as well. Why do we need regulations? For many years, in the opinion of the press and major parts of the public, the shipping industry was seen as a kind of major environmental contaminator. Maybe some of you remember oil tanker casualties like the Exxon Valdez. This appalled the public around the world and was the reason why the IMO, the International Maritime Organization, adopted the first international convention about the protection of the environment, called MARPOL 73-78, with the Protocol of 78. But soon other environmental threats came into the focus of the increasing environmental sensitivity. Waste, sewage, the anti-fouling coatings, transport of invasive species from port to port, or the emissions to air. Presently, the international discussion is dominated by three main issues. Why doesn't it work? Ah, okay. You see, the first one is a convention of ballast water. Alien species in the ballast water of ships was identified as one of the four main environmental threats by the UN, and the IMO started discussions in the early 90s. Harmful invasive species cause serious damages in ecosystems where they do not belong to when ships empty the ballast water in other ports in other areas of the world. The convention was adopted in 2004, but as you see, has not entered into force yet. The reason, of course, it makes high costs for purchase and installation of adequate equipment. These are costs between some $100,000 up to more than a million or $2 million of dollars. Another convention which is actually discussed is a convention for sewage. It's MARPOL Annex 4. One of these annexes to MARPOL convention. Particularly sensitive sea areas like the Baltic Sea suffer from sewage discharge. So the IMO adopted the Baltic Sea to be a new so-called special area for sewage. And that means that from 2021 on, all ships, all passenger ships traveling the Baltic Sea have either to install very effective sewage treatment on board or they have to discharge their sewage into port reception facilities. This is, of course, a challenge to all ports in the Baltic Sea, particularly to those ports who want to be or are attractive to cruise ships, because they are big amounts, of course. And the third environmental issue is a regulation of air emissions from ships. It's a discussion for years now. I would like to take this regulation as an example to demonstrate how international environmental legislation is developed, implemented on international, European, and national level, and how it is monitored. Shortly after the ships started to use heavy fuel oil, it became obvious that air emissions are a serious problem for the environment and for the health of people living along coasts or in big cities along the coast or in ports. So the combustion of heavy fuel oil at that time was named garbage combustion at sea. The close cooperation between member states in the IMO and the industry led to the adoption of MARPOL Annex 6 in the year 1997. this, with a strong reduction or with the first reduction of sulfur. The first idea was to reduce the sulfur sulfur percentage in fuel, in heavy fuel oil. However, the limitation, the international limit of that time was still too high. The same time, in 1997, the MARPOL Annex VI was adopted. At that time, North Sea and Baltic Sea in Northern Europe, for those who are not from Europe, were designated as so-called sulfur emission control areas. The short form is SECA, and I think everybody knows about SECA now. In these areas, the threshold of sulfur content was 1.5% in fuel. It was a first step. The USA, you see the dark blue areas in Northern Europe. These are the SECAs, North Sea and Baltic Sea. And the USA applied for SECAs around North America a little bit later. MARPOL Annex VI entered into force in May 2005. And it was planned from the beginning to immediately start a second negotiation process to reduce the thresholds again. In Europe and in North America, the public awareness of environmental issues grew a lot during the last 10 years. When I worked in the Ministry of Transport, for I worked there for 20 years, I was responsible for different areas, but for a long time for environmental protection from shipping. I remember that we got really big boxes that size filled with letters from environmentalists and from the public which demanded to reduce the, particularly the air emissions from ships. It was one of the big threats during the last, the beginning of the 2000 years. And transportation by trucks and airplanes already had much lower thresholds. These industries as well demanded stronger rules for transport by ships to avoid distortion of competition. It's interesting. USA and the EU Commission both underlined that if the IMO was not able to reduce the air emissions, they would set into force regional regulation, regional legislation. The EU already had a system which limited the sulfur percentage of to 0.1%, you see this in the red line below. From 2010 on, ships at berth and in ports had to reduce their emissions and only to use a sulfur threshold below 0.1%. The majority of IMO countries did not want to have legislation scattered all over the world, a scattered system with different legislation going beyond the IMO rules. And therefore, the revision of MARPOL VI was the only possibility to get a new convention or a revised convention which would be mandatory to all flag states. And this was important. This revision was adopted in 2008. From then, it was decided to reduce the threshold in SECAs, in all these dark blue areas, to 0.1% from 2015 on. And worldwide, the SECA, worldwide, the sulfur limit, sulfur threshold was limited to 0.5% from 2020 on, or at least from 2025, depending on the amount of fuel you can get to that time. This new regime was a kind of revolution. At that time, I had the feeling that the authorities were too fast for the industry, not too slow. The image of the shipping industry increased a lot, at least in Central and Northern Europe. And I am sure it helped a lot to improve the acceptance of cruise ships in the European ports. The idea of the SECA was as well meant to help to introduce cleaner fuels step by step. There are discussions about future SECAs, you see the light blue, but of course nobody knows yet whether they will come or not. We hope that the threshold of 0.5 for the worldwide threshold will enter into force the earlier time, because a better harmonization of sulfur threshold would reduce risks caused by fuel changeovers and create a chance for benefits from the usage of cleaner fuels. You don't have if you still use this high sulfur heavy fuel oil in long distances. But we need more steps. To be effective, regulations have to be implemented and enforced, and the compliance control is necessary. There is an international scheme for the compliance with IMO rules. This is called the port state control. You probably know that. And there are, it's implemented with different memoranda of understandings, like in Europe, Paris MOU or Tokyo MOU in Asia. The port state control regime obliges IMO member states to inspect ships and to exchange information about compliances. The deficiencies lead in the end to a report which tells whether a flag is black, gray, or white. In addition, the European Union came up with an enforcement system, the Sulfur Directive and Implementing Act. This system says that a frequency of inspection in ports should be 10%, and from these 10%, this is inspection of the paper, of the document, of the documentation, and of these paper inspections, 40% have to be taken a fuel sample. The European Union as well has created an information system, TETIS, as it's parallel to the Paris MOU. So I have the impression that we have many systems parallel to each other. In case of non-compliances, you have further enforcement measures like administrative fines or criminal sanctions or detentions until sufficient compliant fuel has been obtained. However, just inspections on a random basis are not very efficient. Therefore, in Germany, like in other SECA states, we use remote sensing technologies to monitor the compliance. And the inspections in Germany are done by the water police. And yeah, I give you an example. 2 years ago, we started a research project together with the University of Bremen, and we work close together with the city of Hamburg. And on the picture on the left, you can see that with remote sensing and optical methods, the air of passing ships is collected, and all the peaks show where the emission, the different gases are collected. And by the chemical mixture of these gases, you can conclude whether the ship which is passing uses the correct fuel or not, or whether the scrubber is okay and works or not. And together with the IAS information from ships, you can identify those ships who have the wrong fuel or a defect scrubber. This works even at to distances of 15 kilometers. And if the measure gives you an indication for non-compliance, the competent authorities in the port, this is the water police in Germany, can be informed, and closer inspections in ports can be carried out. So we need information which can go to a court afterwards. This is just an indicator, not enough for court. Let me show you some results of measurements. First, from the end of last year, before the new SECA regime was in effect. And the second one, the lower part of the picture, is from January this year. And on the left picture, the blue one, you see the sulfur emissions. And it's clearly that in December, ships had a higher sulfur level than in January. What you see very clear is that you have a really effective reduction of sulfur emissions. That this is not accidental, you can see by the right picture, because the green is the measurement of nitrogen oxides. Nitrogen oxide did not get regulated to 1st of January, so they still have the same amount, or maybe it's a little bit better because ships use better or cleaner fuels, but it's not a effect you can see, but the sulfur effect is very significant. And this result shows that the new regulation system is very successful, at least in German waters. So the complete system with remote sensing, the exchange of information in TETES system, the reports, the exchange between authorities, and in the end, the sampling, the closer inspections, are really helpful. Now let's have a look in the end to the implications of the environmental rules for ports and harbors. In Hamburg, as we heard yesterday and you saw probably, the port is right in the middle of the city. The port is a city, the city is a port, we heard yesterday from Jens Meyer. This is a city center and this is a port, and it's connected to each other. This is a big advantage for cruise ships, they come close into the center, and many tourists come to watch big cities. The advantage for a port to have regulations is the image of shipping industry, of cruise ships, and the port is closely connected to a good environment environmental performance. New regulations, of course, create challenges for coastal states and ports. You have to provide resources for inspections and administrative efforts. The use of scrubbers, no, this, but on the other hand, yeah, on the other hand, regulation creates a modernization. You have a progress, a development of innovative solutions, alternatives to the use of heavy fuel oil, like power supply from the shore side, or we heard about the power barge, it's in the upper part of the picture. Here's another picture of the power barge. Are the efforts to reduce the energy in ports, to reduce, to rise the efficiency, are of course not only driven by costs, but as well driven by regulation. Therefore, regulations are really necessary. And these are topics we talk about when we talk about smart port energy. I hope I could give you an impression of how we implement and monitor the effectiveness of environmental regulations and how important this is for progress in ports, progress of technology, and progress in the environmental performance of the shipping industry. I think the maritime industry nowadays is really environmental conscious. It's a success story. It was a big step during the last 10 years. And I think this conference can do a lot to further improve harmonization and cooperation and progress of technologies. Thank you very much.